Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents You Can Have a Better Period, a practical guide to calmer and less painful periods. By Lanice Brothers. Narrated by Diana Blue. Introduction. We all have that one friend. Her periods come like clockwork every month, with no pain and no drama. She gets on with her life and her period comes along on the ride with her. I used to think this woman had won the health lottery. She was one of the lucky ones. You can be one of these women. You can have a period that is pain and drama-free. You can have a menstrual cycle that syncs with the rest of your life. I promise you, this isn't a fantasy. According to the NHS, the average woman has 2 to 3 days of pain, either right before her period or when she has her period. That's the equivalent of between 24 and 36 days of pain each year. If this was any other condition, it's hard to believe that we would allow this to persist. Unfortunately, the inevitability of period pain has been normalized in our culture. By the way, periods and menstrual health are discussed in films, magazines, and on TV, usually as a huge inconvenience or trauma, by the stories that are passed on by those in our lives who have periods, and, for many of us, how our mothers and sisters experienced their periods. We now have the opportunity to change this narrative and change the way we experience and talk about our periods. Pain is a sign from our bodies that something isn't right. It's an opportunity to ask questions and dig deeper, rather than simply accepting this as part of your experience of having a period. Asking questions helps empower us to better navigate our bodies and our health. I know so many of us have been told that it's normal to have painful periods, normal to feel like your hormones are running the show, normal to be an emotional mess before your period. I'm here to tell you that it doesn't have to be this way. This book is your guide to having a better period and understanding your menstrual cycle. My story. When I first thought about the book I wanted to write about periods, hormones, and menstrual health, I pictured the book I wish I'd had to guide me when I was at the worst of my period problems. My period started when I was 13. I was a late bloomer in so many ways, including being the last of my friends to get my period. When it arrived, it felt like a big moment. I was finally transitioning into the next part of my life. And it was, indeed, a big moment. That first period ushered in years of pain, physical and emotional distress, and the start of the ongoing fight I still have with my body. My very first period was strange because I had been waiting for it for so long. When it finally came, I was really disoriented. This new thing had moved all of my anchor points, and I needed to figure out how to navigate my body in a different way. I remember being in the bathroom, seeing the blood in the toilet, and calling out to my family in the living room to say that something had happened, to which my father said, "Oh, did you get your period?" To which I replied, "Yeah, I think I did." It was from that point onward that my body began to feel like such an unwieldy mystery to me. I started to get boobs, hips, and a butt. My clothes fitted differently. I felt more and more awkward. And every month, I had to figure out how to get through this incredibly dramatic event that seemed to be affecting only me so badly. From the outside, my friends looked like they didn't have a care in the world when it came to their periods. Don't get me wrong, I did have carefree teenage moments. I would have about 3 weeks when my life seemed completely normal. I could function like a normal teenager, going to school, hanging out with my friends, reading, listening to music, playing sports, and having massive crushes on boys. Then I would feel the whispers of my period coming, and I'd know that all hell was about to break loose. The fury and the tears would begin. Then 5 days of terrible cramps, headaches, and intensely heavy bleeding. My attitude toward my period transformed from something I was really looking forward to into a monthly source of dread. From the very beginning, I had terribly painful and heavy periods that left me lying on the bathroom floor, writhing in pain and missing days of school. The only things that seemed to resolve it were hot baths that I would sit in for hours, strong painkillers, and sleep. You may be wondering, where was my mother while all this was happening? She was trying to cope with her own period problems. For years, she had periods that seemed endless, sometimes lasting for a month at a time. She told me much later that she didn't know how she got through them, but she thought it was normal. Eventually, she was diagnosed with fibroids, non-cancerous growths on, in, and within the muscular walls of the uterus, and had two removed that were the size of grapefruits. These two fibroids caused years of heavy, month-long periods that left her drained and struggling to cope. Seeing what my mother was going through made me think that having problematic periods was just a part of being a woman, something you just had to cope with. I think back to a particular moment when I was 15 years old, laid out on my bathroom floor in agony from period pain. This was a particular type of pain that felt as though it was stabbing me all over my stomach and legs. I missed school that day and did what became a habit, running and rerunning hot baths that I would sit in for hours to try and soothe the pain. Eventually, I told my mother about my painful and heavy periods. It took some convincing. The distrust of allopathic medicine runs deep in my family. But, in time, she took me to the doctor, who told me what was happening to me was just part of having a period. She gave me a prescription for naproxen, a strong painkiller, and birth control pills, and sent me on my way. Those pills dealt with the pain, but they did nothing for the heavy bleeding and blood clots, so I became an expert in using a combination of pads, rolled-up toilet paper, and tampons to manage the flow. I can't tell you the number of underwear and trousers I bled through. I soldiered on because I believed what the doctor told me and what I saw happening to my mother, that this was just part of being a woman. It was my lot to have painful, heavy periods, wear double pads, and feel lousy for 1 week of every month. How I would have loved to read a book that told me that what I was experiencing wasn't normal, that having a period didn't automatically sign me up for nearly 40 years of pain and suffering, that it wasn't my lot as a woman. I didn't have this book, so instead, I suffered for a long time. I hated my body for betraying me. I hated fighting with my body every time I got my period. As I got older, I started to realize that it didn't have to be this way. Only in the last 7 to 8 years have I had periods that have been consistently straightforward. And for me, that's life-changing. How did I do it? Through nothing that revolutionary or dramatic. Eating loads of vegetables, not drinking alcohol, not eating a lot of sugar or dairy, managing my stress, and being really clear about my boundaries, having a consistent yoga practice, deep breathing, and great sleep. When something changes, like living through a pandemic and all of the changes this has brought, I know exactly what to do to get back to a better place, and that's what I want for you. Helping you have a better period. When you first saw this book, did you scoff a little at the title? Did you think, there's no way I can have a better period? If that's you, I'd like to encourage you to put aside your reservations and to approach this book with an open mind. This book is for anyone who has a period, women, non-binary folk, and transgender men. For brevity, I do use the terms woman, women, and female throughout the book. The best way to listen to this is straight through. However, you're more than welcome to skip forward to the chapters on each phase of the menstrual cycle and start at whichever phase you're currently in. If you're thinking, Whoa, Lanice, I didn't even know that the menstrual cycle had different phases. Don't worry, I've got you. We'll dive into that in part two. I want you to know that you don't have to live with period pain, heavy bleeding, or an emotional roller coaster. That's not an inevitable part of having a period. In my private nutrition practice, I see and speak to women from all walks of life, and two things are clear. Period problems don't discriminate, and women continue to believe pain and suffering are a normal part of having a period. What if I told you they aren't? What if I told you that it's possible to have a period that just happens every menstrual cycle and is as commonplace as changing your underwear every day? Something you do without comment or drama. I believe that once we change our understanding of what's normal and what isn't, painful and heavy periods aren't normal. We change our view of what's going on in our bodies and what we're willing to live with. My own period story has a happier ending. Little by little, I stopped taking the birth control pill, started to make small changes to what I ate, how I exercised, and how I managed my stress. Gradually, I started to see improvements in the quality of my period each menstrual cycle. It became less painful, lighter, and less dramatic. My period isn't perfect. I know that if I eat a lot of sugary foods 1 month, this definitely happened during the first COVID lockdown, I will see the effects of this in my next menstrual cycle. But I'm okay with this, because first, I need to live my life, and second, I know this pain is temporary and I have the tools to fix it. Are you ready to make the changes that can help you have better periods? My hope is that this book gives you the tools to help you tune into your body so you know what's normal for you, and then change your menstrual health for the better. I want to help educate you on why periods are important, so that you understand why the nutrition and lifestyle changes I'll be taking you through in this book will make a difference for the long term. We'll talk about the menstrual cycle and why this is our fifth vital sign. I'll talk through the power of the female body and what we gain from harnessing the different physical, emotional, and mental strengths that occur during each of the four phases of our menstrual cycle. For example, you'll learn why your libido might be stronger during certain times of your menstrual cycle. You'll also learn what hormones actually are, how they guide us, why we're all a bit hormonal, and what makes that a good thing. Learning what's normal and what isn't will change your expectations of your body and yourself. In part two, we'll go through actions you can take during each phase of your menstrual cycle to improve your physical, menstrual, and emotional health. In each chapter, I share specific nutrition, exercise, and lifestyle recommendations for each phase that you can come back to again and again. We'll also cover painful periods, mood changes, and missing or irregular periods in detail in chapters 8, 9, and 10. Finally, we'll talk about how we can put the entire menstrual cycle together so that we can begin to spot patterns and see the effects of changes to the way we eat, move, and in our lifestyle choices. My goal for this book is to give you the tools I use in my private practice as a nutritionist to help you have a better period. My own journey to heal my period and overall health inspired me to leave a 15-year career in advertising and retrain as a nutritionist, eventually specializing in women's health, hormones, and the menstrual cycle. After finishing this book, I'd love for you to understand the power of our natural, feminine rhythm and cycle so that you feel that you are in control of, rather than held captive by, your period and menstrual cycle. I'm tired of women feeling that pain and emotional drama are a normal part of having a period. I'm tired of women planning their lives around heavy and painful periods and feeling like they're missing out. I'm tired of women believing the myth that period pain is normal. I wrote this book because I want you to have a better period. Part 1. Changing Expectations. Chapter 1. Are periods supposed to be painful? Let's go all the way back to the beginning. How did you first learn about your period and menstrual cycle? At school? From a parent, friend, or family member? Did you have to figure it out on your own? My own menstrual health education was pretty scant. I remember a class when I was 12 where we learned the basics. How to use tampons and pads. To expect to bleed each month. To ask our parents for painkillers if the pain got too strong. That was it. I'm going pretty far back into the recesses of my memory here, but I don't recall an extensive menstrual education at school. We spent more time talking about how to avoid getting pregnant than learning about the impact that our bodies and hormones would have on the next 35 to 40 years of our lives, which is so wild when you consider just how many periods we have over that many years. It was only once my husband and I decided to start trying to conceive a child that I started to educate myself. I began reading everything I could get my hands on, learning about ovulation, the importance of cervical fluid, the changes in my hormones and neurotransmitters during my menstrual cycle, and how what I ate and drank could make a difference. It was eye-opening, to say the least. Over and over, I kept thinking, I wish I had learned this earlier. I had spent years living with tough period pain and heavy periods from what I know is likely to be mild endometriosis. This knowledge could have been life-changing. Celebrating our periods. Cultural stories, religious beliefs, and taboos play a huge role in what we think and how we learn about our periods. They influence why so many of us don't know much about our periods, don't understand our menstrual cycle, or simply believe that putting up with pain, a heavy flow, or emotional turmoil is a normal part of having a period. Even today, menstrual stigma continues. Think about the times you might have slipped a tampon up your sleeve or hidden your menstrual products in a special bag before going to the washroom. In a survey commissioned as part of their hashtag No Shame Here campaign, the period equity charity Bloody Good Period found that 97% of respondents had hidden period products because it's the norm. 76% had hidden period products because of embarrassment, and 56% had hidden period products because of shame. Where does this shame and embarrassment come from? My belief is that there are both cultural and religious roots to menstrual stigma. Most religions refer to menstruating women as ritually unclean. Think of the adverts that use blue fluid to depict menstrual blood. Think of the taboo around period sex, actually a fantastic time to have sex because orgasms can reduce menstrual cramps. Or the furtive way many of us first learned about periods or spoke about them with friends. These touch points begin to help us understand why menstruation is thought of as dirty or something to be hidden. When you layer on a cultural belief that menstruation leads women to be physically or mentally disordered, we can start to understand why the unfortunate stigma around menstruation persists. In Orthodox Judaism, the Torah calls women who are menstruating and haven't had a purity bath, nida, and enforces strict separation between a menstruating woman and her husband. The Book of Leviticus, one of the five books of the Torah, states, when a woman has a discharge, her discharge being blood from her body, she shall remain in her impurity for 7 days. Whoever touches her shall be unclean until evening. And if any man lies with her at all, and her blood be upon him, he will be unclean for 7 days. At the end of her period, the woman is responsible for going to the mikveh, a Jewish ritual bath, where she will become clean. Beyond the focus on cleanliness, there is something special about having a ritual to mark the end of your period. Interestingly, some Jewish feminists have embraced Nida as a time of spiritual renewal, akin to what I call going into the period cave. They have also reframed the mikveh as a place devoted to celebrating female biological function. By way of contrast, Guru Nanak, the founder of Sikhism, openly chides those who say menstruating women are spiritually polluted, saying that a mother's blood is necessary for human life and therefore sacred. In Nepal, culture and religion intersect, especially for those living in rural areas. The ancient Hindu practice of chaupati, meaning untouchable being, prohibits Hindu women and girls from participating in normal family activities while menstruating, as they are considered impure and unclean. Although the Nepalese government made this practice illegal in 2018, it persists in rural Nepal, where menstruating women are isolated in poorly ventilated chow huts, livestock sheds, or courtyards outside their home. They are unable to visit temples, use other villagers' kitchen utensils, or wash in communal water sources. As recently as 2019, a woman and her two children died from suffocation after she barricaded them into a windowless menstrual hut during her period. Even in wider Nepalese society, the beliefs that menstruation is spiritually polluting and taboo persist. Let's consider why the belief that periods are supposed to be painful and messy endures. Research has shown that knowledge gaps or deficits in knowledge create confusion as to whether the cultural restrictions and taboos being passed down about menstruation are actually accurate. My own Afro-Caribbean background comes to mind here. The belief that painful periods are inevitable had been passed down without question throughout the generations of religious women in my family. In hushed conversations, we learned we needed to endure when facing pain. These beliefs perhaps had roots in the biblical verse of Genesis chapter 3, verse 16. To the woman, he said, "I will make your pains in childbearing very severe. With painful labor, you will give birth to children." This was corroborated by what we saw in the lived experience of our female family members. As you heard in the introduction to this book, I saw my mother's pain and suffering and expected the same. Throughout this book, I encourage you to question whether cultural and religious beliefs have given you a negative attitude toward menstruation. If the answer is yes, could you ask yourself if there's room to change your beliefs? Is it possible to have a more positive view of menstruation, or to even celebrate it? Let's discuss cultures both past and present. In ancient Rome and Greece, menstruating women were seen as extraordinarily powerful. According to Pliny the Elder, the Roman author and philosopher, a menstruating woman who uncovers her body can scare away hailstorms, whirlwinds, and lightning. If she strips naked and walks around the field, caterpillars, worms, and beetles fall off the ears of corn. I don't think I'll be walking through central London naked in a thunderstorm anytime soon, but it's nice to know that the immense, fiery power of menstruating women was acknowledged at one time. In the present day, the Apaches, a Native American tribe, hold a 4-day sunrise dance, which is an elaborate series of rituals that begin at menarche, the onset of the first period, and prepares girls for the transition into puberty. In Apache, this is called Isanaklesh Gotal, a term which encompasses the process by which the girl is transformed into the Apache heroine Isanaklesh. It is believed that through her participation in the rigors and demands of the sunrise dance and the extended puberty rites, including a series of physical and mental tests that continue for several months afterwards, the girl gains a greater sense of her identity and purpose in the Apache tribe. In contrast to the tradition of chaupati described earlier, some Hindus in India believe that menstruation especially the first menstrual period, is an occasion worth marking. South Indian families hold a coming-of-age ceremony called Ritushudi, or Ritukala Samskara, in which the girl wears a traditional outfit called Alangavani, or a half sari, and receives presents, including her first full or half sari. This can be a complex event lasting up to 16 days. On my podcast, Period Story, I've had conversations with a few women whose parents and family made a big deal of their first periods, using it as an occasion to mark the transition from girlhood to young womanhood. One of my guests, Tamu Thomas, talked about the mixed feelings she had about the excitement this rite of passage caused in her family. Before her first period arrived, she'd been really excited. Once it arrived, Tamu recalls, "There was all this hoopla about me joining the club that I didn't want. My mum bought me this kit. It was bright fuchsia pink, and it had tampons and sanitary towels." Tamu was excited about having her first period, but this was eclipsed by having it shared by her entire family. As an adult, she now understands it's a big coming-of-age thing. It's a huge marker in human development, in female development, and my mom was celebrating that, but I thought a period was just for me and no one else to know about, and I carried that belief with me for a very long time. I wonder how we would feel if our first periods were celebrated joyously rather than hidden away in shame and silence. How would we feel if we knew that our menstrual cycle could be a positive force in our lives to be harnessed for its power rather than something to dread? Having a better understanding of menstruation, hormone health, and how our bodies work is the first step toward removing the stigma. When we talk about what's normal and what it isn't, we can develop positive attitudes about our periods and change negative assumptions. This enables us to push back against culturally accepted norms about periods. Think about these questions. Do you think period pain is normal because that's all you've ever experienced? Do you think heavy periods are normal because of what you've heard from friends and family? Do you accept pain, a heavy bleed and mood changes, because your doctor has told you it's normal? Have you ever gently questioned the origin of your beliefs about your period? As you go through this book, notice if your attitudes begin to change. In this book, we'll go back to basics, starting with understanding that our menstrual cycle and period are one of our five vital signs. We'll move through each phase so we understand what's happening to our bodies during our periods and the rest of our menstrual cycle. You'll also find practical support for period problems and beyond in the later chapters of the book. We'll explore nutrition and lifestyle supports for reducing and managing period pain, missing and irregular periods, heavy periods, and other menstrual symptoms, including PMS, that we've been told are a normal part of having a period. Let's get into it. Chapter 2. Why your menstrual cycle is your fifth vital sign. What does the word vital mean to you? Essential? Fundamental? Something you can't live without? When it comes to our health, we have a small group of important signals from the body that tell us how the most critical parts of our health are functioning. These are our vital signs. When you go to the doctor or hospital, they will check your pulse or heart rate, body temperature, breath or respiration rate, and blood pressure to get a basic understanding of your current health status. Would it surprise you to learn that your menstrual cycle is another key indicator of your overall health? As you listen to this book, you'll learn why our entire menstrual cycle, including our period and ovulation, must be considered another vital sign. Here's another way to look at it. If you don't have a period and you're not pregnant, you get worried, don't you? A delayed period is a sign that something's off. If you don't ovulate every menstrual cycle and you're not on hormonal contraception, it's a sign that you need to investigate further. You might be thinking, my period is so awful. I would be happy for it to disappear. I can relate. When my period was at its worst, I spent a lot of time wishing it away. My hope is that as you listen to this book, you'll add different foods, supplements, and practices that begin a positive shift toward improving your period over time. At the least, I'd love it if you thought slightly differently about your menstrual health. The American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists recommends the inclusion of the menstrual cycle as one of our vital signs, deeming it just as important as the others for evaluating overall health status. Unfortunately, in the UK, the NHS don't yet have a similar view on the importance of the menstrual cycle, but I hope this will change soon. If the menstrual cycle is so critical, why don't we learn more about it in school? That's a great question. As I explained in the introduction, I only learned about my menstrual cycle, beyond my period, when I was trying to have a child. This seems to be a common experience, but this is changing. Menstrual health education was made compulsory in schools in England in 2020, and there are campaigns for this to be extended to the rest of the UK. When I began this project, I scribbled this on a post-it note and pinned it above my desk. Write the book you would have wanted to read when you got your period. As I've been writing, my eyes keep flicking back to this note, helping focus my mind and words on helping you understand the value and importance of your menstrual health. This is where we come back to the significance of treating our menstrual cycle like a vital sign. When something is off, it's a message from our body, and we need to stop ignoring these messages or treating them like they're supposed to be there. Pain is a common example of this. We treat period pain like it's a normal response from the body. Many of us learn this from those around us, and even from medical professionals. It's just a part of having a period, and we should accept it. As I explain in more detail in chapters 4 and 8, we just wouldn't accept this with any other condition. We wouldn't tell someone with tooth pain to just deal with it, would we? We'd tell them, phone their dentist and get it sorted. This is why treating our periods, ovulation, and menstrual cycle like a vital sign empowers us to seek help and support. We know what's normal, what isn't, and we can act accordingly. To truly see our menstrual cycle as a vital sign, we need to understand every part of it. We'll go into the details of each phase in this book, but it's helpful to start with a basic overview, especially if some of this information is new to you. The four phases of the menstrual cycle. Our periods are what we tend to focus on when we think about our menstrual cycles. This is mostly due to the negative experiences many of us have had with our bleeds, including painful periods and mood changes, which I explore in chapters 8 and 9. Let's zoom out and look beyond our periods to our menstrual cycles as a whole. There are four phases of the menstrual cycle: menstruation, follicular, ovulatory, and luteal. The length of each phase will vary depending on the individual, but we would roughly expect the overall menstrual cycle to last between 21 and 35 days. You may have learned that our menstrual cycle should be 28 days. However, many of us have cycles that are shorter or longer and vary by a few days each time. This is normal. In writing this chapter, I got curious about my own cycle and looked back on the data from my period tracker. I have almost 8 years of information. As I scrolled back, I could see that my cycles have been between 22 and 26 days long for the last 8 years. I thought this was abnormal for a long time, and I wondered what was wrong with me. Why didn't I have 28-day menstrual cycles? It's only since educating myself that I understand that I have nothing to worry about. I know that my cycle is highly sensitive to stress, and if I have a few months when I'm more stressed than usual, my cycles will veer toward 22 or 23 days. A quick note, your menstrual cycle is not the same as your period. I've heard some women refer to their period as their cycle, which has resulted in some confusion when I start talking about the menstrual cycle and how long we should expect it to be. The four phases. Phase, menstruation. Inner season, winter. Keywords, surrender, rest, reflect. Approximate number of days, 3 to 7 days. Phase, follicular. Inner season, spring. Keywords, play, energize, begin. Approximate number of days, 6 to 11 days. Phase, ovulatory. Inner season, summer. Keywords, celebrate, dare, connect. Approximate number of days, 5 days. Phase, luteal. Inner season, autumn. Keywords, slow down, organize, breathe. Approximate number of days, 10 to 14 days. I love the analogy of the phases of the menstrual cycle as seasons. This was originated by the founders of the Red School, Alexandra Pope and Shawnee Hugo Wurlitzer. In their 2017 book, Wild Power, they say that throughout your menstrual month, you move through an inner winter, spring, summer, autumn, and back again. Each phase brings a set of specific resources and psychological challenges that help you grow into yourself and your power. My friend, Jen Wright, the founder of menstrual and lunar cycle journal company, Life Aligned, compiled the keywords just listed to guide each season. This is such a fantastic way of thinking about our menstrual cycle because it shifts it away from being a negative experience focused on menstruation to something that reflects the ongoing cyclical changes we experience. It means that if menstruation is hard for you right now, you know that you have the beautiful time of your inner spring and summer to look forward to. I find it helpful to split the menstrual cycle into four phases because there is so much happening during each phase. However, most medical practitioners tend to split the menstrual cycle into two parts: follicular, focusing on procreation and conception, and luteal, focusing on getting ready for menstruation, with ovulation sitting in the middle. It's worth bearing this in mind if your doctor or healthcare practitioner isn't familiar with the four phases of the menstrual cycle. We'll do a deep dive into each of the four phases so that you understand the changes to your hormonal, energetic, nutrition and exercise needs, and even your mental and emotional state. You'll understand why you feel so confident and more willing to take risks during one phase and more risk-averse and inwardly focused in another. And this has benefits beyond your physical health. It can even make you work and study differently and change your expectations for your personal relationships. Hormones and neurotransmitters. Do any of the following phrases seem familiar to you? My hormones are controlling me. I'm so hormonal. My hormones are driving me crazy. It seems to me that we've positioned hormones as bad, and we blame them for the less positive parts of our menstrual cycle. I'd like to change that. We have over 50 different hormones covering different bodily functions, including hydration, growth, energy, hunger, healing, blood pressure, blood sugar and metabolism, stress response, and reproduction. With hormones and neurotransmitters, I prefer to think of them as guiding rather than controlling our bodily functions, almost akin to the way an orchestra works together to play a beautiful piece of music. Let's make an important distinction between hormones and neurotransmitters before we go any further. Hormones: chemical messengers that move through the bloodstream and send messages to hormone receptors on different parts of our body. For example, estrogen is a hormone primarily produced by the ovaries, with receptors on our bone, brain and skin cells, and more. They use a lock and key function. Their hormone is the key, and the hormone receptor is the lock. Neurotransmitters. Chemical messengers used by the nervous system to communicate signals from nerve cells to receptors on cells in the muscles, glands, and other nerves. For example, acetylcholine, a neurotransmitter important for learning and memory, will attach to acetylcholine receptors in the brain, muscles, and heart. Some chemicals act as both a hormone and a neurotransmitter. One example of this is serotonin. When it comes to menstrual health, we usually only hear about estrogen and progesterone. Behind the scenes, there are a wide range of hormones and neurotransmitters that rise and fall during each phase of our menstrual cycle. As you listen through each chapter, you'll learn about these fascinating chemicals. My hope is that the more you understand about how hormones and neurotransmitters affect our menstrual health, you'll better understand your body and perhaps change your expectations about what you can and can't do. As we'll explore in the next section, our cyclical nature brings certain strengths to the forefront during different phases of our menstrual cycle. What to expect during each phase. The physical, biological, hormonal, and mental changes we experience during each phase of our menstrual cycle are a compass we can use to guide us. We tend to have the expectation that we should feel the same every day. When we acknowledge changing physical and mental energy, changes in mood and mental focus, we have the amazing ability to play to our strengths. It allows us to let go of any guilt for not being on 24/7. I remember a conversation I had with a client, whom I'll call Maria. Maria was frustrated that she couldn't grind on her business goals with the same energy all month long. She worked hard and saw her period and the lack of energy she felt during this time as a betrayal. I encouraged her to begin to reframe how she looked at her period, considering it an opportunity to create space to recharge so that she could jump back into her work life feeling more energized and better than ever. We looked at how cyclical changes in hormones and neurotransmitters alter our cognitive skills, memory, mood, communication skills, and mental focus. I suggested she use the introspective mental energy of the menstrual phase to focus on reviewing what was and wasn't working in her business and make big decisions. She was resistant because she had been working in 24-hour cycles for so long. Slowly but surely, being mindful of where she was in her menstrual cycle and how she was feeling helped her understand that she couldn't work the same way all cycle long, but she could work in a way that acknowledged the cyclical shifts in her mental focus. This applies equally to our physical energy. As we'll explore, our physical energy rises and falls across our menstrual cycle, which has implications for the way you move your body, the exercise you do, and even what you eat. Being aware of this helps you let go of any guilt about not being able to crush your spin class or your run every time, especially as you move to the end of your cycle toward your next period. Phase/inner season. Menstruation/winter. Physical energy. Energy at its lowest point. Mood. Reflective and inward looking. Mental focus. Review and evaluation, introspection, decision-making, focus on self-care practices. Phase/inner season, follicular/spring. Physical energy, energy starting to rise. Mood, positive, social, outgoing, adventurous. Mental focus, increased creativity and interest in starting something new. Phase/inner season, ovulatory/summer. Physical energy, peak energy. Mood, daring, risk-taking. Mental focus, peak resilience. Communication skills and confidence are at their strongest. Phase / inner season. Luteal / autumn. Physical energy, energy starting to decline. Mood, focused, changing. Mental focus, focus on what you know, getting through your to-do list, detail-oriented. Do you relate to any of this? Think back to your last period. Did you push yourself more than you needed to? Did you feel guilty about going a bit slower at work? Take some time to think about how you might do things a little differently next time. Now that we know that our menstrual cycle is one of our five vital signs, I encourage you to explore what this means for your menstrual health experience. What is your cycle telling you? What have you been ignoring? If you're not sure yet, not to worry. In the next chapter, we'll discuss what a normal menstrual cycle should look like. I hope this will continue to shift your understanding of what's happening to you. Then, in part two, we'll get into what you can do to begin to change things. Chapter 3. What's a normal period and menstrual cycle? I want to start this chapter by exploring the word normal, because I know it can be a loaded term. When we say that something is normal, there is an implication that there is a standard that we should look to achieve and that anything outside of this is abnormal. There are many wonderful examples of how people are pushing back against the word normal. Take Unilever, the manufacturer of Dove, Simple and Lynx, removing the word normal from its beauty products. This is a positive step that reminds us of the diversity of our world and reflects changing beauty standards. In the health and well-being space, we see similar changes. We're seeing movement away from using outdated and racist tools such as body mass index, BMI, as a marker of what is normal in terms of overall health. This body measurement tool was introduced in the 19th century by the Belgian mathematician Adolphe Quetelet. His work centered around identifying the characteristics of l'homme moyen, the average man, collecting his data from white, French, and Scottish men. He developed the Quetelet Index to assess weight across a population rather than on an individual basis. In the 1970s, the researcher Ansel Keys popularized the use of this flawed tool as an easy means of measuring body fat, using his influence in the American medical community to push for the use of BMI over the ideal weight-to-height ratio tables used by the insurance industry, eventually being used worldwide as a proxy to assess adiposity and overweight-related issues. I feel hopeful about the body positivity movement, which looks to redress body size norms, asking us to consider why white, European female bodies have been seen as the standard for so long. I personally prefer body neutrality as a way of thinking about my body. For me, this means that thoughts of clothing size or weight become less important, and there is an acknowledgement that some days we may feel great about ourselves, and other days we might not. It doesn't mean that we hate ourselves. It simply means that we are cyclical beings with changing hormones and perspectives. Layering in the menstrual cycle here, if we think about our inner spring and summer, we're more likely to feel more positively about ourselves. Compare this to our late inner autumn, when hormones like estrogen and progesterone are dropping and neurotransmitters like serotonin and dopamine aren't as high as they are earlier in our menstrual cycle, at which time we might not feel as positively disposed to our body. There has also been a pushback against medical research that primarily uses men as the standard. There are real-world consequences when the impact of cyclical hormonal changes is not factored into research design. Take autoimmune diseases such as rheumatoid arthritis. Alzheimer's, and multiple sclerosis. These conditions affect 8% of the global population. 78% of those sufferers are female. In her 2019 book, Doing Harm, Maya Dusenberry discusses how under-researched and underdiagnosed these conditions are in women, explaining that the research typically focuses on how the symptoms of these conditions appear in men. This often leads to women being taken less seriously when they approach their doctor about their symptoms, and they end up having to wait longer to receive a diagnosis. When it comes to specific women's health conditions, the conversation is more nuanced. There is still a lack of research into endometriosis, fibroids, adenomyosis, and polycystic ovarian syndrome, PCOS. Combine this with the education gap in menstrual and hormonal health, and many of us still don't know what to expect when it comes to our period. Think about the culture and religious beliefs we talked about in Chapter 1. If these, along with knowledge gaps and deficits, create confusion about what is normal and what isn't, then my belief is that it's important to put a stake in the ground. This isn't meant to shame anyone for having a period or menstrual cycle that is outside the norm. I'm also not advocating healthism, which places the problem of health and disease in the hands of the individual, rather than acknowledging that there are also systemic and political issues, such as the lack of consistent and equitable access to health services, or lack of research into women's health, that contribute to menstrual and hormonal health issues. What I would like to elucidate in this chapter is that there is a healthy continuum when it comes to a normal period and menstrual cycle. This means that you're producing enough estrogen to build your uterine lining. You're ovulating every cycle. You're making enough progesterone, and you're able to continue to live your life, even when you have your period. Contrary to what you may currently believe, if you're outside of this spectrum, there is a way to change things. Later in this book, we explore endometriosis, adenomyosis, fibroids, premenstrual dysphoric disorder, PMDD, PCOS, and hypothalamic amenorrhea, HA. When I work with my clients in my private practice, I talk to them about what to expect from the period and menstrual cycle, given in the following table. We then look at where they differ from this norm, what we can do to change this and support their overall hormone and menstrual health. Menstrual cycle length, 21 to 35 days. Period length, 3 to 7 days. Menstrual flow, more than 30 milliliters. 1.01 fluid ounces, less than 60 milliliters, 2.02 fluid ounces, around 6 to 7 fully soaked regular tampons or pads, 3 to 4 full 15 milliliter, 0.5 fluid ounces, menstrual cups each period. Menstrual color, bright red for most of the flow, some dark red towards the end is fine too. Menstrual pain, light cramping, aches. Energy, high during ovulation and low but not completely exhausted during menstruation. Ovulation, midway through cycle, not always on day 14. Cervical fluid, changing after menstruation, peak fluid resembles egg white and indicates ovulation. Temperature, before ovulation, between 36.1 degrees Celsius, 96.9 degrees Fahrenheit, and 36.7 degrees Celsius, 98 degrees Fahrenheit. Just after ovulation, between 36.4 degrees Celsius, 97.5 degrees Fahrenheit, and 37 degrees Celsius, 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit. Mood, more sociable and outgoing during inner spring and summer, less outgoing and more focused during inner autumn and winter. The role the menstrual cycle and periods plays in women's health. Do we even need to have a period every month? Because so many of us have a hate-hate relationship with our periods for a variety of reasons. We question the need to have a monthly period and menstrual cycle. While we can take the hormonal contraception that stops menstruation, I think it's valuable to consider the role our menstrual cycle plays in our overall health, so we understand that it's about more than just our period. Without a menstrual cycle, we won't produce enough estrogen and progesterone, two of the sex hormones that are involved in many of our body's non-reproductive functions and systems. Estrogen influences our metabolism, vaginal lubrication, bone health, mental health and cognition, libido, cholesterol levels, and even how we feel pain. Estrogen is connected to serotonin levels, so without it, we would see our mood plummet throughout our menstrual cycle. And then there's progesterone, the incredible anti-inflammatory hormone we produce when we ovulate. It helps calm us and improves our mood by supporting GABA, a brain neurotransmitter that has a sedative-like effect. Progesterone helps us get better sleep, reduces bloating, lowers blood pressure, improves the function of our thyroid, and has a protective effect on our breast tissue. I know that some of you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.